On this channel, I often talk about the possibility of alien life, but I don't really draw much of a distinction between levels of life as far as discovering it goes. I'd be just as happy to detect alien microbial life as I would be in discovering a full-fledged civilization. In other words, I'll take anything I can get that confirms life in the universe independent of our planet. And while I think intelligent life and civilizations are probably rare, one aspect of life on Earth gives me confidence that we are probably going to find no shortage of simple or even moderately complex life in the universe. It's the sheer resilience of some species of Earth life, so much so that a handful of species can withstand the rigors of space. Other than the obvious lack of atmosphere, one major threat to life that space poses is ionizing radiation. Exposure to this radiation is measured in units called grays, and a mere 5 grays is enough to kill a human being. And anything above 8 is certain death for most life on Earth. There are only a few species of animal that can stand a bit more, such as the German cockroach, which I suppose unsurprisingly can handle up to 64 grays, and also the resilient fruit fly, which can take 10 times that. Most of the microbes also have problems with radiation. E. coli, for example, can only handle about 60 grays before it starts dying. But there are a few organisms on Earth that not only can withstand radiation to truly amazing levels, but can withstand the vacuum of space, so much so that we may someday find them living on some of the other bodies in the solar system. And they also may be among the last living organisms on this planet when the sun finally destroys it. The first of these is actually a family of animals rather than a microbe, albeit a very tiny animal. It's the famous tardigrade, a truly amazing group of species that can go 30 years without eating, live for over 60, and survive a whopping 5,000 grays of radiation. They can withstand temperatures near absolute zero to above the boiling point of water, and they are found in all environments on planet Earth and can even survive the dryness of space for a decade in a sort of dried-up suspended animation that ends once they are returned to water. In one case, a tardigrade that had been bone dry for over 100 years was reanimated, sort of. It moved a leg, though no one is really sure if that qualifies as being brought back to life. Regardless, that particular tardigrade might not make the best material for a Frankenstein-esque reanimation story. Tardigrades can even survive astrophysical phenomena, and in fact have survived all of Earth's mass extinctions that have occurred since they first evolved. In a study done by David Sloan and Raphael Battista, link in the description below, they took a look at the threats that face Earth that can cause mass extinctions of most life on Earth and found that gamma ray bursts, nearby supernovas, and even asteroids all fall short in their ability to cause the extinction of the tardigrade. Only the events surrounding the evolution of the sun will do it, though even then, if they've colonized other places in the solar system, they may continue to persist there. But even the tardigrade has its limits. It can't really be classed as an extremophile like some of the microbes, because while it is incredibly resilient, it's not really designed for the harsh conditions that it can withstand. When dried up or frozen, they can't reproduce or do what tardigrades in normal environments do. And that brings us to something else entirely. That's the lichens, some of which seem to be radio-resistant. Jean-Pierre de Vera and colleagues showed that certain types of lichens protected by niche environments could survive, photosynthesize, and grow on Mars. Add that with research done on the International Space Station, where certain species of lichens survived up to 18 months in the naked conditions of space, and you have a possible scenario of Earth lichens colonizing Mars through panspermia. But now we get to some organisms where radio resistance reaches ridiculous heights. The first is called Deinococcus radiodurans, and like the tardigrade, can survive multiple different types of adverse conditions, including very high ionizing radiation, 3 times that of the tardigrade at 15,000 grays. Remember, 5 grays kills a human and 60 kills E. coli. D. radiodurans was actually discovered because of its radio resistance. In 1956, Arthur Anderson was experimenting with sterilizing canned food, and while expecting to completely sterilize a sample with very high radiation, he found that he did not, due to this bacterium and his sample spoiled. The reason for this bacterium's resistance is that it can rapidly repair its own DNA on an order that almost every other organism on Earth cannot. This has led some researchers in the past to wonder if this organism is even from Earth. While the ability to dry out or go without food is useful, there's really no good reason for an organism to evolve such radio resistance in Earth's low radiation environment. That opened up the notion that it might have evolved on Mars early in life's history in the solar system, and was transported here via panspermia, or, alternatively, perhaps it spent some part of its evolutionary history in space. This has been largely discounted, however, because as resilient as D. radiodurans is, it bears much genetically in common with the rest of life on Earth. Work done by Valerie Mattimore of Louisiana State University showed that the radio resistance is more likely to be a happy evolutionary accident brought on by evolving an ability to completely dry out. The radio resistance was merely a chance side effect of that. Or maybe not. The most radiation-resistant organism found on Earth is a relative newcomer to science, discovered only in 2003. Named Thermococcus gammatollerans, this organism is a mystery. It's very different from D. radiodurans in that it belongs to the archaea rather than the bacteria, and it likes deep ocean hydrothermal vents where things don't usually dry out. While it doesn't seem to be well suited for the rigors of space, this organism can handle radiation like nothing else on Earth. It can sustain a mind-boggling 30,000 gray dose of gamma rays, and no one knows why. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently wondering if there are any dormant tardigrades in the room. I'm surrounded, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.